May it please the court, good afternoon. My name is Ted Hong. I represent the appellant, John Rodrigues, Jr. With the court's permission, may I reserve 5 minutes for rebuttal. In its order granting summary judgment on December 30th, 2019, the district court wrongly interpreted the scope and application of LAOSA, and there were material facts in dispute that should have gone to the trier of fact. My first point I'd like to make this afternoon is that LAOSA preempted state law and provided a private remedy under Section 1983. The district court did not address the preemption issue or the private remedy issue under Section 1983. In the City of Los Angeles case versus AECOM 854.
Can I ask a question before you get there? Because I think you have a decent argument on preemption, is my sense. But I think one reason that it may not be relevant, and I'd like to hear your response to this, is there was probable cause to arrest Mr. Rodrigues for the threats that he had previously made. And so even if there was not probable cause, for whatever reason, to arrest him for the gun charges, and I grant you that there's some questions there. Why should we even delve into that? Why doesn't our analysis begin and end with, was there probable cause based on the prior threats that were made while holding two guns? And that's the beginning and the end of the analysis.
I appreciate the question, Judge Nelson. The reason is that in terms of Title 18, and this ties in with my preemption argument, in terms of Title 18, there's a comprehensive statutory scheme. And so in this particular case, if he violated or carried or transported or possessed firearms as a qualified retired law enforcement officer, then he would be subject to criminal charges under 18 U.S. Code Annotated 922A1A, which would be a 5-year penalty in jail under 924A1D as in Delta. And with respect to the terroristic threatening issue, that would have been a violation of 18 U.S. Code Annotated 924C1A. And depending upon the particular acts, that would have been either a 5-year or a 10-year sentence, 5-year sentence under 924C3 and 4, and a 10-year sentence under 924G4. My point in terms of the preemption issue is, if, as the district court found, he was a qualified retired law enforcement officer, then if he violated LAOSA, he was subject to federal prosecution, not state court prosecution. In terms
Stop.
Of that,
what there preempts state law? Why couldn't he be charged with a state offense?
The reason why he couldn't be charged with a state offense, Your Honor, as the district court found, was he was a qualified, retired law enforcement officer.
That doesn't authorize him to engage in terroristic threatening.
If those charges were proven, or if there was probable cause for...
No, stop. Probable cause. Was there probable cause for an arrest is the question that's been put in front of you. And to be honest, I haven't heard anything that answers that question. Why was it... What? So answer this question. This is a yes or no question. Was there probable cause for arrest?
No.
Regardless of what the charge was, why wasn't there probable cause for arrest on that threatening charge?
Because in our case, there were two separate incidences. The first happened at 10 o'clock.
That's not the answer you gave me. I asked you, was there probable cause for any offense? And you said no. So I asked you about the threatening charge. Answer the question again. Was there probable cause for arrest on the threatening charge?
No, there wasn't probable cause to arrest on the threatening charge.
Why not? Even your brief, as outlining the facts on page 5, seems to me to indicate probable cause.
Again, there are two separate incidences here. One involving Mr. Figueroa, one involving Brooks and Lopez. We had, and in the Third Amendment complaint, we are alleging facts with respect to Mr. Brooks and Figueroa. The fallacy in the...
You're trying to crawl out of my question again, because I posed a question specifically about the threatening charge, and you're trying not to answer that question. This is your last try. focusing. You can tell me it's irrelevant. I don't believe it is, but you can tell me that. But you're not answering my question. Was there probable cause for arrest on the threatening charge?
No, there
and
wasn't.
Don't tell me that you're disregarding that episode, because that's not answering the question.
No, there wasn't probable cause under state court law or federal court law to arrest my client with respect to terroristic threat.
How can you say that? Because he was carrying guns? Is that why?
He had guns on his possession.
Okay, let me ask this hypothetical. You have a man not carrying any weapons. He goes up to somebody and he says, I'm going to kill you. I'm going to shoot you. You're going to die. That person feels threatened, calls the police, and the police come and arrest the man for making threats. Does probable cause exist in that scenario?
Probable cause would exist in that scenario. I submit, however, in this particular case, those hypothetical facts do not apply because the facts were muddled. If you look at Detective Almeida's report and also Detective Kalii's report, who was the officer or the detective in charge of this investigation, Detective Kalii said that the threat that was made was conditional, and that was the concern. So was there probable cause to arrest my client?
Let me read from your brief. Your brief, page 5. According to Mr. Figueroa, the appellant said he could put a bullet in Figueroa's head and that no one would find him. That's your brief. How is that not probable cause?
I would point out that that statement was based on what my client said to the police commission 5 months after the event. And that's at the excerpts of the record 4 and 5, and also the supplemental excerpts of the record, pages 1 through 4. Those statements.
I'm reading from your brief.
I understand.
If that's what
Mr.
Figueroa said, how could that not be probable cause?
Where did those statements come from, Your Honor? My point, what I'm trying to make in terms of that point is, the district court was wrong because it pulled those statements that my client said before the police commission 5 months later, and found and folded those in terms of what was said and how it was said.
Isn't it true that at the time of the arrest, that Figueroa had already relayed to Kalii about what had happened, so that at the time of the arrest, that information was in the possession of the arresting officer?
Yes, Your Honor.
Then that's probable cause. If they relayed that to the officers, what Figueroa said, is enough. You don't have a trial on probable cause. He provided information to the officer sufficient to constitute a terroristic threat. Why isn't that probable cause?
I disagree, Your Honor, because again, when you look through Detective Kalii's report and also Detective Almeida's report, they put down that the threat that was made was, quote, conditional under state law. And again, one
conditional
of the concerns,
on what?
The statement was made that if you don't convey this to Mr. Brooks, then I'm gonna shoot you.
You're allowed under Hawaiian law to make conditional threats to shoot people?
In this state, if you were going under state law, one of the defenses that was identified and recognized by the police officers and detectives was that a conditional threat is not a threat that you can use for terrorist threatening. And I just want to jump back on a particular issue.
But that may be a defense. That may be a defense at trial. You may make that to a jury on why you shouldn't be convicted. But how in the world is a conditional threat not probable cause for arresting for the threat?
I would submit, Your Honor, that in terms of the statements that were given to Detective Kalii and also Detective Almeida, that what was said was not as clear as I think that the police.
Let me read to what you cite in your brief. It had nothing to do with the statement by your client months later. It is to Officer Kalii's report. Figueroa stated the male party stated to him that he was a cop for 20 something years. You think I don't know what I'm doing with this, and something to the effect that he's going to put one bullet in his head and nobody going find him. that's pretty compelling evidence that there's at least probable cause, isn't it?
Again, Your Honor, our position is that probable cause with respect to Figueroa is probable cause with respect to Mr. Figueroa. My client was never arrested with respect to what happened to Mr. Brooks and Lopez. And that's why, again, from our perspective, and we have always alleged from the beginning of this case, that there are two separate incidents.
Do you have any legal support for the proposition that you disregard probable cause if it wasn't for events that are happening on the same day? You disregard probable cause for one offense and focus only on the other alleged offense. Any support for that?
These were not one continuous series of events with individuals. These were separate events. This is like
they all happened on the same day, didn't they?
Your Honor, I agree. So that what you're saying, Judge, is if I can take your position, is if I have a carjacking earlier in the morning and then I hijack another guy in a carjacking later on in the afternoon, I can be charged with that probable cause for the first carjacking would apply to the second, and I disagree.
What I'm saying is that the arrest is supported by probable cause, and you don't have a 1983 action for some kind of false arrest. If there was probable cause for the arrest, that kind of ends the story. As I understand the law, and I'm asking you, do you have any law to support your proposition? That's not what it is. I haven't seen anything yet.
I agree with the court, and I think this is a unique circumstance, and I would submit that there is no case law to support what I think the court is saying with respect to this probable cause from another event applying to a separate, a different event at a different time of the day. I would note with respect that I'm running out of time in terms of my rebuttal argument, and I would ask the court to proceed.
You want to reserve the rest of the time? Okay, that's fine. Thank you. Mr. Horowitz.
May it please the court, Anna Horowitz on behalf of the appellees. The district court did not err. Summary judgment was proper. The undisputed facts, based largely but not exclusively on plaintiff's own sworn testimony, demonstrates that the appellees were entitled to judgment as a matter of law. As your honors have pointed out, this case turns on whether probable cause existed, and we feel that the record reflects that probable cause did in fact exist, which means that the 1983 claim is without merit, and in any case, he would be entitled, arresting officer would be entitled to qualified immunity.
Yeah, I understand that argument. I do want to ask, though, about probable cause. Let's say there had not been the prior harassment, which, does obviously change this whole thing. But with regard to the firearms claim, is the government's position that there was probable cause for arrest on the firearms issue?
Yes, Your Honor, we believe that there was probable cause to arrest on the firearms issue, and I understand that there is some of the questions about Leosa. Our position is that Leosa applied to at most one of the weapons, and that means that the other weapon, that because Mr. Rodrigues, the appellant, was discovered with two weapons in his vehicle.
Oh, but I thought he had a permit under Leosa for both weapons.
Your Honor, respectfully, Leosa applies to carrying a concealed weapon, a single concealed weapon, which would have covered one, but not the other. And therefore, the other one was carried in violation of state law. So Leosa, our position is that Leosa...
Back up, because how did he get... He had a permit for both weapons, correct?
Correct. He had a permit to own both weapons, yes, Your Honor.
Oh, I see. But your position is federal law would only protect you as to one of those weapons. The other one wouldn't fall under Leosa.
Correct, Your Honor. And so because of that, the unprotected gun, which we believe based on the undisputed facts.
Can we put that kind of weight on the use of the singular in Leosa when the Dictionary Act in Title I says that when the singular is used, it includes plural unless the context suggests otherwise? Here in Leosa, does the context suggest otherwise? Seeing that it can cover as many weapons as meet the criteria.
Sure, Your Honor. I understand that, and that argument was made before the district court. To that, we contend the question of the analysis of probable cause is based on objective reasonableness. A plain reading of the statute of a firearm, our position is, would entitle the arresting officer to say a firearm, a singular firearm, and therefore it could be
a qualified immunity argument.
That's yes, Your Honor.
Okay.
But that doesn't answer the problem.
Is it a qualified immunity? I mean, it may be, but it seems to me what I heard you say is that for probable cause, it doesn't mean you've got definitive proof leading to a conviction. I think you're trying to say that the standard of probable cause, suspicion, reasonable suspicion that a crime had been committed, that the officer may not have been aware of the rule that A, which otherwise is taken to be singular, means plural, doesn't by itself defeat probable cause.
Correct, Your Honor. That would be.
And then you have your additional argument with regard to being qualified to carry some of the guns, and I don't want to deprive you of that, but as I understand, the starting point is that Judge Collins accurately observes as a federal statute that interchanges singular and plural. I don't know if there's any law that says it's going to defeat probable cause if an officer doesn't know about that.
Correct, Your Honor. The reason that argument, and perhaps it may have come out in the briefs a bit convoluted, the reason that argument was made in that manner is because this was a motion for summary judgment before the district court, and therefore the facts had to be taken in the light most favorable to the appellant. So taking all of those arguments and facts in that favor, the best we could articulate that argument as being that even if the officer had known all of those things, had been well versed in constitutional and federal law, which again he does not have to be under the standard, then taking that, it could still be reasonably interpreted that a firearm means a singular firearm, and therefore there would be clear probable cause to arrest the plaintiff.
Okay, so I want to back up, because separate and apart from kind of the preemption and the Leosa arguments, let's just focus on probable cause under state law, because I would assume if he had been arrested at the scene, you know, with two guns and he didn't have a card, I would tend to agree that there was probably probable cause there. That's not what happened. What happened was he was pulled to go to the police office. On his way, they got the second report that, hey, he's been threatening this other person. They put him, in a holding room, you know, but they knew, they had actual knowledge. They knew he'd been a former police officer and had had a weapons permit. Why wouldn't they have taken the time to go and check whether he had a weapons permit? And shouldn't they have had to do that in these circumstances where there's no immediate threat? He didn't have access to his weapons at the time. He's in a separate holding room. They had actual knowledge at that point that he was an officer who likely had a permit. Why wouldn't they have had to check that? And if they checked that, then they would have known that they didn't have probable cause for the firearm.
Respectfully, Your Honor, and to that end, I respectfully disagree with that. He did have a permit pursuant to Leosa, as our brief details.
No, not pursuant to Leosa. I thought he had a state permit.
I'm not sure I understand the question. Oh, go ahead.
You need, for Hawaii law, you need to distinguish between ownership and ability to carry. And I think what counsel's talking about has to do not with ownership, but as you know from other cases, Hawaii law is very restrictive with regard to the ability to carry either open or concealed. And I don't think there's an argument that he had a state of Hawaii permit or a county permit for that, but he had the right given to him under the federal statute. And so he arguably did not need a state separate permit to permit him to carry. I'll ask counsel to let me know if that's his understanding of the facts.
Yes, Your Honor, thank you for clarifying. I apologize for not including the full section from HRS. And to make that clear, used to.
He was charged not with possession, but with transportation in violation of Hawaii statute.
Yes, Your Honor. Under our HRS framework, transportation of firearms, there's certain restrictions that need to be followed.
Yeah. Has to be at a certain... I understand that. And so that's what he was actually charged with. He was not. Okay.
I hope that answered the previous question you had then, Your Honor.
I think so.
Okay, thank you.
But did the officer at the time have sufficient information? Was the officer aware of sufficient information to have probable cause that Leosa did not apply? Because I thought there was a fact issue as to whether the officer even looked at the ID card. And so if he doesn't look at it and doesn't know what it says, does he have enough facts at that point?
I understand the question, Your Honor. Respectfully, the issue was more along the lines of whether or not whether or not the appellant even presented that identification and that those certifications to the police so that they could make that. Because he never did, although under the...
I thought he claimed that he did. Am I mistaken on that? And on summary judgment, don't we have to take his version?
Correct, Your Honor. We do have to take his version. However, even the appellant was inconsistent about whether or not he did. He said he may have, and yet he never actually provided the documentation, the exhibits showing that he did, when in fact the exhibits taken, if we look at the exhibits objectively, the firearm certifications, the identification card that he did have, it doesn't match up to the requirements under Leosa. So therefore, even if...
Right. My question was whether the arresting officer knew that it didn't meet Leosa.
Correct, Your Honor. And to that point, as I was trying to point out, even if the appellant had presented everything, there's no possible way that the arresting officer could have known that Leosa might have applied, because Leosa didn't apply because the appellant didn't have sufficient documentation to show that he in fact complied with the federal statute of Leosa. And so based on that, he had a reasonable suspicion that the crime, at least as far as the weapons were concerned, to arrest at that point in time, never mind the harassment and terroristic threatening, which also provided probable cause. I guess at the end of the day, the appellant was an admitted criminal who was seeking money for his lawful arrest, which the district court correctly determined he was not entitled to, and therefore we hold that the district court's decision should be properly affirmed.
Thank you, counsel.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Mr. Hong, you have about 3 minutes for rebuttal.
Thank you, Your Honor. If I can clarify, Judge Collins had pointed that out correctly in terms of the record on appeal, is that my client has been...
I'm not hearing you. Could you try to get a little closer, please?
I apologize. Judge Collins was correct in his recitation of the facts. My client specifically said on numerous times that he presented his photo ID card under Leosa to the police officers, Detective Kalii and Captain Jelsba. They refused to look at it. So that's one of my concerns. One of the other concerns that was raised in this particular issue is whether the arresting officer should have known what Leosa says. I submitted that it does, because back in September 17th of 2014, at the record of excerpts of the record, 214 through 215, it shows that all the police chiefs and the Attorney General's office were aware of what Leosa required, signed a memorandum of understanding, and said that the Attorney General's office is going to supply more instructions, more regulations with respect to how Leosa was going to be carried out, and it was never done. So Detective or Captain Medeiros, Sergeant Leloy, who've been in the department for over 20 some odd years, Sergeant Leloy, 29 years, submitted declarations at the summary judgment level saying that at no time in their career had they been trained or given any training on Leosa and what Leosa...
There was only one arrest. And even if you're right on everything about Leosa, does it matter if there was probable cause for the one arrest based on the terroristic threats?
I'm sorry, Your Honor. Could you repeat that for me, please?
He was only arrested once. He wasn't arrested twice. And so even if there were all the problems you say with Leosa, does any of that matter if the one arrest is justified by the probable cause to arrest him for the terroristic threat?
No, Your Honor. In our case, and what our argument is that, again, Leosa preempts state law. He shouldn't have been subject to arrest with respect to any state.
But there's one arrest. If I'm an arresting officer and I have a menu of possible offenses and I arrest that person and I'm aware of what I think are two offenses, one I'm completely wrong, I don't have probable cause, but the other one I do. Isn't that this situation? You know, even if you're right on Leosa, there's still probable cause for the one arrest on the terroristic threats ground.
I disagree, Your Honor. Under the Villanueva case, 2021 Westlaw 28076 at page 3 talks about whether the officer acted reasonably. And I submit that in terms of the officer's actions in this particular case, they did not act reasonably. And that's kind of carried out in footnote 19 of Judge Kaye's decision in the record on appeal. And I see that my time is almost up. I just wanted
it is. But we have your argument. We have your briefs. That we appreciate the well articulated arguments from both counsel.
I wanted to thank the court for the opportunity to argue via Zoom, and also I want to put on the record. I wanted to thank the court staff for making this process so much easier. I very much appreciate it. Thank you.
We're all unanimous in that. Our staff is incredible. So thank you. They'll appreciate that. That case is submitted, and we'll move on to our third argument. I do believe we will take a short break after this third argument and before the fourth argument.